The National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated stations present The Pacific Story.
This is the story of the Pacific, the drama of the millions of people who live around this greater sea, where the United States is now committed to a long-term policy of keeping the peace. This is the background story of the events in the Pacific and their meaning to us and to the generations to come. Silk, the golden thread.
That the East and the West shall be tied together by a golden thread. It shall reach across the seas and across the mountains and the plains, and it shall encompass the world and be a token of peace. But war shall come, and calamity shall come, and they who fashion the golden thread shall suffer. Men will search the earth for a thread its equal, but they shall find none until again there is peace. And the people of the East and the people of the West live together, one with the other.
Today, the silk looms are again spinning in Japan. The mills, smashed by the war, are being put back into operation. And the mills converted from silk manufacture for war industries are now being reconverted to silk. But a great deal of water has gone over the dam since Japan's silk heyday of 1929.
Oh, isn't this exciting?
Hey, we're lucky to get in. This place is very exclusive, Pat.
What if they raid the place while we're here?
Oh, not this place. Nick has got a fix.
Gee, Wilbur, you'd never know from the outside that this was way down in the cellar.
They say Nick sank $50,000 in this peak.
Yeah.
Oh, look, here comes our drinks. Well, what do you say, Alphard?
Too much business. That'll be $1.06. For two gin rickeys.
And $2 for cover charges. This gin is direct from Cuba. Imported.
I'll bet Nick made it in his bathtub. I'll lay ya.
Thanks.
Well, he's looking at you, honey.
At you.
Oh, brother. They must have made this stub out of motorman's mittens. Phew.
So isn't this the way gin rickeys are supposed to taste?
Come on, Pat. Let's dance, huh?
Why not?
Well, at least the music's good.
Oh!
What's the matter, baby?
Oh, that girl stepped on me way up on my heel.
Yeah? Hurt you?
Let's sit down.
Sure, I'll run interference for you.
Oh, look at that. She stepped way up on my heel. And look what she did to my stocking.
Yeah, ruined them.
Yes, look at that. Brand new silk stocking.
Well, don't worry about it, baby. I'll buy you another pair. I'll buy you a half dozen pairs. What do you think about that, huh? Now, come on. Let's not let this wreck our evening. Hey, Alphonse, fill them up again.
That was 1929. That was the height of prosperity, the peak of the Prohibition days. That was the year when everybody had money and everybody was spending it. That was the year that Japan sold to the United States alone 100 million pounds of silk. That was the year when the golden thread meant nothing more than a run in a young flapper's sheer hose. But there was an age when silk was the fabric of kings. And in China, 3,000 years B.C., the process of spinning and weaving the thread of the silk cocoon was a carefully guarded family secret.
Observe. Observe closely, my daughter. For this tiny creature, which crawls on the leaf of the mulberry tree,
will serve you in all your lifetime as it served me and my father before me. It is the silkworm.
See, Father, how even now it covers itself with the silken fiber, spinning a cocoon.
And from this cocoon, my daughter, you in turn will spin the golden thread to delight the hearts of all mankind.
Yes, Father.
The raiment of princes and emperors will be woven from what you spin. Documents of state will be written on your silken cloth, and messages and the stories of our people. It is a heaven-sent secret. Guard it as you would your life.
I will remember, Father.
Come now to the marketplace with me. At sundown, the caravan departs for Lulang, carrying silk for Bata in the Occident.
For nearly 3,000 years, all the silk known in the civilized world was made in China and carried by slow caravan west through the mountains over primitive trails which came to be known as the Silk Road. The journey was muddy, sometimes years long. The first stop was Lu Lan, an ancient fortress near the shores of Lake Lopnor.
Whoa! Stop the caravan! Hold the animals! We must wait outside the walls of the city.
Why do they not open the gate?
Sentry! Open the gate! It is the caravan from Tun Wang! Sentry!
Your shouting will wake the dead.
Welcome! Welcome, caravan!
Oh, look there. My cries have roused the village. Even now, men are climbing from the wall.
Good. They come to examine the cargo.
Welcome, caravan! Welcome, merchant!
Greetings, men of Lulang.
You have come far?
Across the great desert from Tun Huan. My men are weary. They are impatient to enter the city.
Our village rejoices at your arrival.
What good do you bring to Lulan? We bring silk from Xi'an, 4,000 bales.
Break open the packs for the sentry to see.
Silk?
It is silk! The silk from Xi'an! The silk!
Aye, we bring silk enough and more to clothe all your village.
Clothe the village? No, merchant. To the people of Lulan, silk is no vain adornment. It is too precious to be worn. To us, it is bread for our families. For with your silk, we can buy wheat from the caravans which come from the west. To us, your silk means life.
Open the gates for the caravan! They bring silk!
Good! Caravan is headed!
In Lulan and other junctions on the Silk Road from the Orient, silk was a medium of exchange. The bales arriving from Xi'an were in turn sold to other caravans traveling west who carried the silk to more distant cities, Byzantium, Antioch, Tyre. None but Roman patricians could afford to deck their wives and daughters in the luxurious fabric of the East.
It is beautiful. Father, it is beautiful.
Perhaps you will wear it at the Colosseum.
Oh, it is so soft. It is surely the finest material that has ever been made.
It should be fine for the price the scoundrel charged me.
Did you find it in the marketplace? I have never seen it before.
It is called siricum. A seaman brought it from Tyre. Where it really comes from is a mystery. Somewhere in far eastern Asia, it is said. The process is a secret known only to the seers, or Chinese, as some call them.
For 2,600 years, the Chinese did manage to keep their secret. Although their caravans stretched the golden thread across half the ancient world, the secret process of producing silk was not revealed until in the 3rd century of the Christian era, a Chinese princess married a prince of Tibet and brought a strange wedding gift to her husband's court.
Sire, Her Highness, the Princess of China.
We welcome the Princess of China.
Your Highness.
Rise, Princess.
Your Highness is most generous. If it please your Highness, I would ask permission to remove my headdress.
Here, Princess? Now?
Now, your Highness. I bring a gift for my people.
You offer the headdress of a princess as the gift of your people?
That which is concealed within the headdress, my prince.
Is this a jest, Princess? I see nothing. Or perhaps my eyes are not so keen. Here. Here, courtiers.
Yes, sir?
What do you see?
Well, I don't...
What? Why, it is worms, your highness.
Worms?
In the head.
A joke! A wedding gift to worms!
Your highness, please. I do not jest. This is a gift from my people to the people of Tibet.
Your forgiveness, princess.
What I have brought are silkworms.
Silkworms?
The true silkworms that have been a source of China's wealth for 3,000 years.
Silk from worms? A miracle.
No miracle, sire, but a knowledge which I shall consider an honor to impart to your people.
Princess, you bring us a great gift. If our people can make silk, they shall never want. This is truly a gift to our people.
It is written that a golden thread shall encompass the world as a token of peace. But war shall come, and calamity shall come.
Flee! We must flee! The enemy is upon us!
But the Emperor Qin!
The House of Qin has fallen! We are lost! All is lost!
Oh, but where can we go? This warfare among brothers of our land, where is there left to go?
Quickly, there is no time. We go to Korea. We are leaving the country at once for Korea.
But husband, our home, all we worked for is here. Our possession.
We can take nothing except the silkworm. Quick, while there is time.
With the fall of the Qin dynasty, refugees streamed into Korea, carrying as their only possessions their silkworms and the knowledge of silk production. And from Korea, the secrets of silk spread further abroad. From across the Sea of Japan, in the 3rd century B.C., the general Semiramis led his invading army against the Koreans. The semi-barbaric Jap horde easily conquered the more peaceful Koreans and returned with prisoners and loot to their homeland. General Semiramis reported to the throne.
Victory, Excellency. Korea is conquered. I come only now from my vessel. And our fleet, Semiramis. Safe. Our ships are safely returned. Their holds filled with tribute from the enemy.
You bring captives?
Many captives, Excellency. And a prize more precious than jewels.
More precious than jewels?
The secret of the white cloth of China. I have brought silkworms, Excellency, from which the golden thread is produced.
A silk?
And captives who will teach our farmers how to reel the silk from the cocoon and weave it into fabric.
This is indeed a prize, Semiramis.
I have brought also the bush of mulberry on which the silkworm feeds.
A plant?
It is part of the secret. The leaf of the mulberry tree is eaten by the silkworm as food.
And then we shall plant mulberry trees throughout the land. It is my will that an edict be issued at once. Wherever possible, our farmers will cultivate mulberry trees and learn the culture of silk. As an example to the people, the Empress will tend our silkworms with her own hand.
That was the Emperor Nin Ken more than 2,000 years ago. That was the beginning of Japan's silk industry, which in 1929 had grown to a $100 million a year export trade. An industry which was to provide Japan's second most important peacetime foreign credits. In that time, men of many lands have marveled at the silkworm, each in his own way.
My entire family engaging in manufacture of silk in all our lifetime. Honorable father, mother, grandmother, son's wife, and the 4 children.
From youngest child to great-grandmother, 9 silk workers in one Japanese farmer's family. Multiply that by the 2,200,000 families engaged in the silk culture in Japan before the war, and see how closely, from birth to death, are the lives of the Japanese literally entwined with silk. But while they lived, ate, and slept with their silkworms, the average Japanese wore no silk. It was far too valuable a commodity to be wasted on clothing for domestic use, as long as 100 million pounds could be sold to the United States in a single year at $5.23 a pound. For in the United States of the 20s, women controlled purchasing power. And at their demand, U.S. weavers became Japan's best raw silk customers. The American wives defended their prerogatives.
But, Wilbur, you're just being unreasonable.
You talk of silk as though it were a luxury or something.
Well, I don't care what you call it, Pat. All I know is we're spending entirely too much money lately.
Oh, Wilbur, don't be uphill. We gotta have silk.
But why? Why must it be silk, Pat?
Don't ask me why, Wilbur. It's just something that's important to a woman. Why, no girl I know would think of wearing anything but silk lingerie. And as for stockings, well, just ask yourself how many cotton stockings you've looked at lately.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, now, look, darling, I don't mind doing the housework. And have I ever said a word about taking care of three children without any help?
Oh, honey, I'm not criticizing you. It's just that
I've never asked you to buy me a washing machine or, well, a lot of things I might have. But clothes mean a lot to a woman. Oh, honest, darling, I just couldn't do without silk stockings.
Okay, baby, silk it is.
The American woman's inability to get along without silk stockings was more than just a philosophic observation in some circles. To certain Japanese meeting with government officials in Tokyo in 1936, it was an important military calculation.
There is too much talk of silk and not enough talk of our imperial destiny.
Well, gentlemen, I beg of you. We are traveling a fool's course. Since the turn of the century, when our economy was open to world trade, silk has been vital to the strength of our basic economic structure.
It will continue to be so.
Our people have prospered in the peaceful production and export of silk. More than 34% of our farmers depend for their entire livelihood on the raising of silkworms and the processing of raw silk. The industry cannot be turned to military use without disaster.
This is pacifist talk.
What best serves the interests of our people serves also His Imperial Highness.
I give you the facts. Our armies need steel from America. We need oil from California and the East Indies. We must have chemicals and other medical supplies. And we must have them now.
General, I must warn you that increasing silk production to gain greater foreign credit for purchasing the raw materials of war is dangerous. More than half of our export is to the United States alone. Already they consider our acts unfriendly.
You are unduly alarmed, sir. Japan produces more than three-fourths of all the raw silk in the world.
That is correct, General.
Then, as an officer in His Majesty's Imperial Army, I can safely assure you that your American silk market will in no way be jeopardized. They must buy from us. American women would never give up their silk stockings, even for a war.
Shanghai, urgent. Without formal declaration of war, Japanese ships in play today bomb the city of Shanghai. Large portions of the city are in ruins, and thousands of refugees are streaming into the international capital.
It had begun. Japanese intentions were now clear. But the prophecy was not entirely accurate, for on the campuses of American universities, strange meetings were taking place.
Okay, we girls can take a joke. But now that you've had your laugh, listen a minute.
You tell them, Sally.
We're not wearing these cotton stockings to be funny. It's not just a fad to attract attention, either.
I know, it's a minstrel show.
On the level, listen, fellas. We like silk stockings just as much as any girls do.
And it's going to be pretty tough to go without them, believe me.
I don't know how to say it without sounding corny, but
what she's trying to say is, we're boycotting Japan.
Yes. We've seen what's happening in China. We know that every pair of silk stockings we buy means more bombs for Japan's Air Force. Every silk dress means more bullets for Japanese rifles, killing Chinese babies today and tomorrow, perhaps our own. Let's stop them now.
Yes, let's
stop. But the earnest resolutions of an intelligent minority in the United States were not enough to stop the military machine that had been set in motion by the warlords of Japan. In 1939, meetings were being held in Washington.
But, Senator, I wish to point out that since Japan took on her war in China, she has been buying twice as much as she has sold to the United States.
But on the evidence thus far presented,
no government action can possibly be taken. True, our economic relations with Japan have greatly altered, but no overt act has been committed.
Mr. Senator, I wish to go on record as stating that Japan's purchases from us are entirely in the nature of raw materials for war. To pay for these imports, they are putting the squeeze on our silk market.
Gentlemen, if I may speak at this time.
Certainly, Mr. Naturo. Gentlemen, I asked Mr. Naturo of the Japanese embassy to come here this morning in the hopes that he might be able to clarify the position of his government.
Thank you, Mr. Senator. I wish first to assure you for my government that if a change has occurred, it most certainly has not been a hostile one. The gentleman who spoke before me has charged that we are withholding raw silk from the market in order to increase prices.
I certainly did, Mr. Naturo. Silk mills in my district have informed me that the price of raw silk has reached a 9-year peak. Since last December alone, it has been raised $1.75 a pound. And some types of silk can't be had at any price.
Unfortunately, the price rise is true. But your reasons are not entirely correct. You must understand that my country is at war.
Either the Japanese were being very clever in taking advantage of their world domination of silk, or they were desperate for a means of lowering their import balance. In Berlin, another type of conference was being held. In the private dining room at the Hotel Adlon.
Oh, excellent Kümmel, Herr Schmidt.
Thank you, schön. Here, let me pour you another glass.
Oh, thank you. Your dinner was most enjoyable. You seem to have no shortages considering it is wartime.
Nein. We have no shortages. Particularly, their friendships are involved.
Oh, yes. Then perhaps I may be permitted to mention a matter of friendship between our two governments.
Naturally. Karl. Ja,
mein Herr.
We will be disturbed by no one.
Zu Befehl, mein Herr.
Good. You were saying, Herr Kurota?
The matter of machinery and the chemicals which your government has so kindly offered to sell.
I can guarantee you that shipments will begin at once.
Mm-hmm. And as a payment for these materials, Herr Schmidt?
Let us be frank, Kurota. Your silk is of minor importance to Germany at the moment. We are at war. Any interference, shall we say, you could create for our enemies in the Pacific would be payment enough. And you may be assured that if for any reason your American silk market is cut off, the German government is prepared to supply Japan with sufficient raw materials to fight for her place in the world.
Well, this is indeed a friendship, Herr Schmidt.
Let us drink. To friendship.
But a war with Russia and the blockade by the British kept friendship from fulfilling its commitments. By the fall of 1941, there was a showdown in the Far East. Japan had occupied half of China and moved down into Indochina.
We must make it plain to Tokyo that we will tolerate no further move. Economic sanctions must be imposed at once.
Britain's stand was strong, but a more serious blow came from the Dutch in the East Indies.
The Dutch government hereby finds it necessary to abrogate its oil pact with Japan, providing for the shipment of 1,800,000 tons of oil per year to the Japanese Empire. As of this date, no further oil will be shipped.
And in the Congress of the United States?
I wish to call to the attention of Congress that in cooperation with the Allied powers and in the earnest hopes of checking the worldwide spread of the Japanese war, the United States, as of this day, declares an embargo on the import of Japanese silk.
With only 4 months' supply of raw silk, American silk mills were hard hit by the embargo, and the American women turned to cotton and rayon and a limited supply of nylon hose. But the Japanese people were harder hit. They were piling up silk at the rate of 700 to 800 bales a day, as if caught in some ironic fairy tale bewitchment in which riches and luxury mount in unwanted profusion. Demonstrations were held in the streets of Tokyo.
We demand a strong action against the United States for this unfriendly act. Listen to me. It is no matter if the United States will not buy our silk. They are enemies of Japan. We will soon be at war. And our silk will go to war as medical sutures, electrical insulation for our planes and those parachutes. And what we do not sell abroad, we will wear. Look among you. Already it is possible for us to clothe ourselves in silk.
But what false prosperity is this? Where we wear silk, but can't buy food for our family.
Yes, Japan's silk had gone to war. Once again, in its 5,000 years history, the golden thread had been broken by warfare. And calamity had come to those who fashioned the golden thread. But today, silk once more promises to play an important part in the life of Japan. According to General MacArthur's headquarters, the silk trade may be one of the first industries to be revived in a peaceful Japan. And the matter of Japanese silk is closely related to the matter of food for Japan.
Unless food is sent to Japan, many Japanese will die in the months to come. The food imports required can be paid for with silk. Silk is an agricultural product of wholly domestic origin, requiring no outside raw materials, and therefore offers the best opportunity for Japan to gain rapidly the needed foreign credit. If silk can be exported at pre-war prices, it would be more economical for the Japanese to import grain and use their acreage for silk production to pay for it.
Once again, the silk looms of the East are spinning out their golden thread. Silk production may never again be as great as it was in 1929, but it may become the most important single factor in the reestablishment of Japanese economy. And China, a victor in the greatest war of all time, may again pick up the golden thread.
For it is written that the East and the West shall be tied together by a golden thread. It shall reach across the seas and across the mountains and the plains, and it shall encompass the world and be a token of peace. They who fashion the golden thread in peace shall prosper, and the people of the East and the people of the West shall live together, one with the other.
You have been listening to The Pacific Story, presented by the National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations, to clarify events in the Pacific and to make understandable the cross currents of life in the Pacific Basin. For a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. May I repeat? For a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. Pacific Story is produced and directed by Arnold Marquis. The original musical score was composed and conducted by Thomas Peluso. Your narrator, Gain Whitman. Programs in this series of particular interest to servicemen and women are broadcast overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. This program came to you from Hollywood. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.